huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much, Mr. Satya. Thank you so much, Dr. Batra. And ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker is an IT czar and a big risk taker. So without much ado, let me invite on stage Dr. Lalit S. Kanodia, the founder chairman of Datamatics Group of Companies, to kindly come and speak on Unforgotten Indians in Forgotten India, the joy of being an Indian. A huge round of applause for Dr. Lalit S. Kanodia, ladies and gentlemen.
Mr. Satya Brahma, Dr. Batra, fellow speakers, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here today. The theme is very interesting, perform or perish. And I think to perform, you need some of the ideas that I'm going to put forward to you in my speech this evening. The subject that Satya Brahma gave me was talk about unforgettable Indians in a forgotten India. And I reflected on it. I said, indeed, we may have forgotten India, and we may have also unforgettable Indians. We have lots of great Indians in the past. But can we rephrase this by saying the need to rewrite the history of India? We need to rewrite the history of India to generate pride in our nation and our citizens. And we have so much to be proud of. I do have a few copies of my speech. I write my speech, though I never speak from it. I speak extempore. But for those of you who want it, I do have copies there. And if you send me an email, I'll be happy to email it to you. No problem on that. I believe to really succeed as a nation, besides ability, which of course you need ability, you need two essential components, pride and passion. Both of these are very, very important for us to be able to succeed in whatever we do. Let me illustrate this. If you talk to the Swiss, they're proud about their watches and their chocolates. If you talk to the Germans, they will tell you German engineering. There's nothing like it in the whole world. If you go to Holland, they'll say, look at our cheese and our tulips. Have you ever seen this anywhere else? And pride matters. I think it really makes you do what you do and it makes you succeed. One instance of this is the Swiss watch. As you know, when the quartz watch came in, the Japanese overran the Swiss, and Swiss watch is not available, it's not seen. And again, the pride in Switzerland have made them come back. And now you find, again, they are number one when it comes to the watch industry. Now, I sincerely believe that all of us in this room, and all of us in India for that matter, live in a country that has no peer, there is no duplicate of India. There is no country even remotely close to it. And we may have forgotten that. And let me talk about why I say this and why I'm so proud of our heritage and why we should be proud of this country. Let's start with education. Today is the knowledge economy. And education is the most important component in any country. And you look at the education in India. Takshila, the oldest university in the world, was created in 600 BC. I repeat, 600 BC. The second oldest university in the world, Nalanda, came in 427 BC. It's unimaginable that these universities had as many as 10,000 students. And they came from all over the world, by the way, not only from India. This is an amazing fact which most of us don't know. The world famous Chanakya was in fact a professor in Takshila. When I mentioned this to Susan Hockfield was the president of MIT, and I happened to be on the board of MIT, which is now rated the best university in the world. And I told her this, she was shocked. She didn't know this. And when I sent her all the details, she said, my God, I've learned something today. Can you imagine a university in the world, the oldest university in the world, two of them were in India. Compared to Oxford, 1096 AD, Cambridge, 1209 AD, Harvard, 1637 AD, and the young MIT, 1861 AD. Imagine that Takshila is 1600 years before Oxford. What a feat. What a feat that you should be proud of. Let's talk about GDP, something which we feel ashamed of today. The OECD, in a publication just a few months ago, reminded us that India had the highest GDP in the world. I repeat, the highest GDP in the world for 1,500 years. 1,500 years. It had the second highest GDP in the world for the next 300 years. So 1,800 years, we are either number one or number two. It's only in the last 200 years that we have had a problem, and we'll talk about why we've had a problem, what we need to do about it. Let's talk of medicine. The oldest medicine in the world, Ayurveda, is as old as the Vedas, thousands of years old. And many people don't know this, but the first cesarean operation in the world was performed by Chanakya on the queen in the Maurya Empire in 370 BC, 400 years before the birth of Christ. And as a consequence of that, Bindusara was born. And Bindusara, as all of you know, was the father of one of our greatest kings, King Ashoka. Most of us don't know this, that the world's oldest cesarean operation was done 370 years ago, but none other than Chanakya. Talk of astronomy. Now, all of us in this room pray to the Navagraha. Navagraha is something which we, in all our prayers, we have it. We knew, now if you look at the Navagrahas, five of them, by the way, are the planets. If you can talk about it, then we have the sun and the moon, seven, and the two imaginary planets, Rahu and Ketu. But India knew of the five planets on Earth, six planets, from thousands of years. The world famous, there's a very famous astronomer who knew the circumference of the Earth with 99.8% accuracy several thousand years ago. So this is what we knew about astrology. Mathematics. We gave the world zero. If we didn't have zero, the world would not have had mathematics. And more important, Madhavan, equally important, a mathematician in Kerala, invented calculus in 14th century of AD, when the credit is given to Isaac Newton, who lived in the 17th century in AD. So 300 years before Isaac Newton, India had already invented calculus. And that's why it's so important to rewrite India's history. These are all facts, by the way. This is not imagination. So we need to rewrite history to be able to record all of this. Religion. Hinduism, I don't know how many thousand years old it is. Buddhism, 600 BC. Lord Mahavir, Jainism, also 600 BC. And by the way, Mahavir was the 23rd Tirthankar. So there are 22 people, Tirthankars earlier to him, that talked about Jainism. And the world gave the world its this concept of religion, and we can talk about that a little more. Now, history has recorded the history of North India quite well. You look at the Maurya Empire, for example, 350 BC to 185 BC before Christ. Or you talk the Gupta Empire, 320 AD to 550 AD. We've written about the Mughals. We've written about Shivaji. But unfortunately, we've not recorded the kings of southern India, which I think is really a tragedy. Now, I was reading up southern Indian history, and I was astonished to see the richness of what they've done and the dynasties that they had. And I'll just name some of the dynasties to tell you how many there were. The Cholas, the Pandya, the Cheras, the Satavahanas, the Pallavas, the Kadambas, the Chalukyas, the Gangas, the Rashtrakutas, the Hoysalas, the Kakatiyas, the Mansuris. I don't know how many of us have even heard these names. But history has not even recorded it. Let's talk of one of them. The Cholas. The Cholas, who ruled in 300 BC, by the way, as long ago as that, they had conquered Sri Lanka, Indonesia, the Philippines, the Maldives, Bangladesh. Unimaginable, right? and we have probably not heard about this. And they ruled for 1,500 years. The Cholas were in power for 1,500 years. Look at the Chedas from Kerala. Again, 300 BC to 1100 AD. 1,400 years. And all of the empires, I won't bore you with all of the empires, all of these southern Indian empires were prevalent all over Asia, and they held sway for a very, very, very long period of time. Let's talk about how nations influence one another. All nations try to influence one another. And I believe there are four main techniques that are used, which we should talk about. One is religion. Second is marriage. And we'll talk about why marriage can influence nations. Third is trade and commerce. If you trade and you have commerce, you can influence nations. And last but not the least is the military power that you have. And nations have used these four techniques to influence the world around you. Look at Christianity. Christianity has had so much influence around the world, but nations have influenced one another. The entire example, the Crusades, were fought for over 100 years thanks to Christianity. Look at Islam. You know, it has made a tremendous difference how nations influence. Islamic countries come together very quickly. But let's talk about marriage. Many may be surprised to know that there's a very famous family called the Habsburg family in Austria, 1276 to 1918. Now they, as a policy, had their daughters in the Habsburg family got married to almost every king in Europe. Hard to believe. They did it very systematically. Even the wife of Napoleon, Marie Louise, was a Habsburg. Now marriage can unify. Marriage can make a tremendous difference between nations. Look at what Italy has done to India. Sonia married Rajiv Gandhi. Now, this may sound humorous, but the fact of the matter is the amount of influence that Italy has on India today is thanks to Sonia, the fact of life. Now, many of you may not know this, but the daughter of Stalin, Svetlana, married an Indian, Brajesh Singh. We did nothing about it. We never leveraged that equation, which we could have done. And I don't know how many know this even, that fact that the daughter of Stalin, the famous Stalin, was married to an Indian. You look at trade. What can trade do? The East India Company started trading with India. And where did it end up? Finally, it conquered India. So trade can be a tremendous influencer. And of course, finally, military power. Almost all European countries conquered almost the rest of the world only thanks to military power. So these are the four techniques that we need to use. Now, India has leveraged all four techniques, which history has not recorded, from 300 BC, from Ashoka's time, up to 1500 AD. For a long 1800 years, India did use these techniques, which we need to understand. For example, religion. India used religion, and all of Asia initially became Hindu and later Buddhist. And if you ever travel across Asia, right from Japan, China, all of Southeast Asia, you'll find the tremendous Indian influence that exists in almost every single country there. But let me tell you some other facts. Let me talk about marriage, for example. And this is something which may surprise everybody. Most people, it surprised me anyway, that in 48 AD, 48 years after the birth of Christ, a princess from Gaya called Ayuta set sail with a brother in a ship, all the way to South Korea. Mind you, 2000, Columbus sailed 500 years ago. She sailed 2000 years ago, all the way to South Korea, and married the king. Name was Kim Suro. It's a very happy marriage. They had 12 children, 10 sons, and 2 daughters. 8 million Koreans are descended from her, which includes the first lady today, the former prime minister, and the former president. Now, how many of us know that? 2,000 years ago, an Indian princess from Gaya went all the way to Korea and married the king. It's an amazing fact. Cambodia, a Brahmin girl married the prince of Funan, which is a province in Cambodia. And the prince of Indraprastha founded Cambodia. And Prince Jayaraman II ruled over Cambodia from 800 to 850. So look at the influence that India had on Cambodia. Burma, the prince of Kapilavastu, which is now in Nepal, became king of Burma. Now let's look at Indonesia. We had tremendous trade with Indonesia for over 2,000 years. And the South Indians from Kalinga, which is a province on the southeast of India, used to travel to Indonesia. And even today, if you go to Indonesia, they're called Klings, by the way, even today. We were in Bali a month ago, and I was absolutely shocked at the influence that India has. On the streets of Bali, you find statues of Ram, Sita, who they're called Sita, by the way, Hanuman, Krishna, and Arjun. I was absolutely staggered because Indonesia is a Muslim country. And I was shocked that in a Muslim country, there is a state called Bali, which is 80% Hindus, and where you have all of these statues on every street of Bali. It's an amazing thing when you go there, when you see this. India also had tremendous influence on the two Indonesian empires, the Sriwijaya Empire, where the kings of that empire were called Maharajas, by the way. And the names of the kings are all Indian, though they were local Indonesians. Indravarman, Rudra Vikraman, Vishnu, Sridev. Can you believe it? Look at the amount of influence that India had with them. And the relations with India were absolutely stunning, absolutely stunning. Rajendra Chola, unfortunately, attacked Indonesia in 1025 and captured Sangram Vijay Tungram Varma. And that ended that empire. I don't know why, and history says we don't know why he did that, why he went there and attacked them. He took a navy, went to that place, and attacked the king and took him captive. And that ended that empire. But then there was the Majapahit, which flourished thereafter. We have Kirta Raja, who was the king, who married an Indian girl. Her name was Tribhuvana, by the way. Now you see the influence that India has had through marriages. And then he married four sisters, by the way, the king. So he had five wives. The names of those four sisters, interesting enough, Tribhuvaneshwari, Pajana Pramita, Narendra Duhita, and Gayatri. Now these facts are really hard to believe, that the kind of influence that India had on this part of the world.